just going to open us up with a quick word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you once again for allowing us to be here and to be able to just gather freely and worship and honor your name, and not only that, but to listen to your word, Lord, and take that in. And I just pray that everybody here not only listens with their ears, but listens with their heart, Lord, and just takes everything in, and that the words that you want spoken are spoken this morning. Be with Brother Andy as he brings the message, and be with all of us as we lead this congregation in worship this morning, Lord. I just pray that we're joyful in spirit, and just humble in attitude as we lift up your name. It's in your great and awesome name. Amen. So if you guys want to stand, this one is a new one, so if you don't know it, don't feel bad, but it's going to be stuck in your head for the rest of the day because it's already stuck in my head. You can thank Janine.
Step out of the shadows, step out of the grave. Break into the wild, don't be afraid. Run into wide open spaces, graces waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted, graces waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here. Come out of the dark, just as you are.
multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life gracefully broken. My heart stands in awe of your name, your mighty love stands strong to the end. You will fulfill your purpose for me. You won't forsake me, you will be with me. Here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life gracefully broken. Yeah. Here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life gracefully broken. It's all to Jesus now, and all to Jesus now, holding nothing back. He's holding nothing back. Let's sing that again. It's all to Jesus now, all in Jesus now, all to Jesus now. Jealous for me, loves like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I'm unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us.
Oh, how he loves.
this chorus with me one more time. We're going to change it. Change it to how he loves me.
He loves me. Oh, how he loves me. Oh, how he loves me. Oh, how he loves me.
Such amazing love.
Yes, he loves me. Oh, how he loves me. Oh, how he loves me. Oh, how he loves
me. Thank you, Lord. Y'all can go ahead and be seated. Brother David.
Matthew 26, verse 26 through 28 says, "Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, after blessing it, broke it and gave it to the disciples, and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.' And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sin.'" So as I read that, I want to take a minute to look at the lives of the disciples, the lives of everybody in that time. We often look at the scope of the world that Jesus lived in, and we think of it as so different than ours today. But as I think about, you know, some of the big things in our world that we spend so much of our time thinking about and dwelling on, so right now we obviously coronavirus and disease in our world. But in Jesus' day, they had whole camps of people with leprosy. They had, you know, disease that was running rampant, and they took those lepers and at, like the plague that it was, and put them in whole camps by themselves and wouldn't even go near those people, yet Jesus did. And then at that time, the Roman government controlled the whole vast majority of the known world, and right now I hear a lot of people talking about all the things wrong with our government or other governments or different conspiracy theories, and yet in Jesus' day, they were under the Roman government, which was arguably one of the most oppressive, worst governments in the entire history of the world. So the people in that day were not so different from us today, and yet when Jesus called his disciples, they left everything. They left all of those worries. They left all of the big things for an even bigger thing and followed Jesus. And I like this passage. This passage starts out, "Now as they were eating," which refers to all of the disciples there with Jesus. They were not concerned with the lives they had before. They were not concerned with what else might be going on. They were concerned with eating with Jesus. They were concerned with being at the table. Before Jesus could have his Last Supper, before he could give communion, he had to have people that came to the table. So that's where the disciples were as we come to communion. They were at the table. They were present. And we move from their present to Jesus took the bread. Now, it doesn't say he stood up and said, "Hey, everybody, give me your attention. I've got something big to say." It says he took the bread. Now, the disciples, of course, they were there when, in John 6, he talks about, "I am the bread of life." Jesus says, "I am the bread. I am the manna that came down. Those who eat of me will have life forever." And the disciples were there for that. They were there when he took the bread and broke it, spread it around. They saw the miracle of it multiplying. They were there again when he did the same thing to the 4,000. So when Jesus took the bread, he got their attention. It wasn't a big thing. He just took the bread, and they were all paying attention. So when he did that, knowing all of the miracles he had done, seeing what he, or being present for when he talked about being the bread, they saw him take the bread and they were expecting a miracle. They were not, you know, it was just in the middle of their meal. It wasn't a special Passover to them. It certainly wasn't their first Passover. They had been having Passover feasts all their life, and this wasn't Jesus' first Passover feast with them. He had been with them for a few years. So it was just another Passover to them, and yet when he took the bread, he still got their attention because they were expecting a miracle when Jesus took the bread. So I wonder today if we are in a place where we can come to the table. If we are present enough with Jesus that when he takes the bread, when we take communion and we come to the bread, if we are paying attention and if we are expecting a miracle. Now he moves on to that. There was no healing, there was no great magic that happened. But when the disciples expected a miracle happened, and they understood that it was a miracle that happened. And that miracle was moving on to the cup. And Jesus said, "Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant." The disciples, they were accustomed to a covenant. They were under the covenant of the law that God gave Moses all the laws, and all of the Pharisees and hypocrites kind of twisted that around, and they were under a lot of oppression even from the Jews on which laws they had to follow and how they had to follow them, and they were very familiar with that. So when Jesus says, "This is my blood of the covenant," they know that he's performing a miracle. He is saying, "You are no longer under all of these laws. You can have freedom and forgiveness and life in me because my blood covers your sin. My blood has the power to forgive your sins because he came down to earth to forgive our sins." And that's what life is about. Life is Jesus. Jesus is the bread of life. And that's what we celebrate with communion, that Jesus came and he was with us and he was life. He is what it's all about. It is all about that he came to earth so that we can take the bread, take Jesus, spread him around, that we can tell everyone we meet that Jesus can set us free, no matter what disease, no matter what government, no matter what is wrong with the world, Jesus will still set us free. Today, as you take communion, I'd like for you to meditate on that, that no matter what's going on, are we coming to the table? Are we expecting a miracle? And do we praise God for the miracles that he does perform? Because he performs them all the time. And after communion, it says that the disciples sang hymns of praise because they knew they had received that miracle. Do we know in our lives that we have received that miracle when we take communion? I'm going to pray for communion real quick, and then I'm going to talk about tithe for a second. Lord, we come to you today, and we thank you for the gift of communion, the gift of letting us see a physical example of what you have done in our lives. Lord, I ask that we would not take communion lightly, but that we would see your gift for the miracle that it is. It is the, regardless of what other miracles you performed on earth, the gift of salvation is by far the biggest miracle that you could have ever done. Help us today to recognize that and see you for who you are and what you've done in our lives. don't pass the plates right now, so I'm going to go ahead and talk about tithe a little bit while I'm up here. But in Matthew chapter 6, verse 24 and 25, it says, "No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. Therefore, I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing?" As we take communion, it's a celebration of the life that Jesus gave us. And I always find it, whether it's on purpose or not, but I always find it very appropriate that we have tithe of the offering right after communion. Because as we celebrate the life that Jesus gives us, we have an opportunity to, it is the easiest, most straightforward opportunity to demonstrate that we believe in the communion that we just took. We believe in the life that Jesus gives us. The Bible says we can't serve God and money. So the question is, in the easiest, most straightforward way that God gives us, do we trust God? Do we trust Him to cover our finances? But not only that, do we trust Him that we'll still have a job tomorrow? Do we trust Him that we'll still have food on our table and clothes on our back? Do we trust Him, or do we trust ourselves? If we trust God, He gives us life, He gives us freedom, He gives us forgiveness. If we don't trust God, then we're putting anxiety and stress on our own shoulders. Right now, we're not passing the plate, so we just have the plate in the back, and we have online giving, or you can mail in a check. But whatever you do, I would challenge you to make sure you're giving. That is the easiest, most straightforward, unquestionable way to say, God, I trust you, because I'm not in control of my life. You've given me life. You've given me this freedom, and I'm going to trust you with it. Because without God, we don't have life. We don't have freedom. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for the opportunity you give us to serve, the opportunity you give us to give back to you, and how you make everything clear to us that we need to know. You're not a God that tries to keep secrets from us or hides some big mystery that we can't find salvation or find you because you're nowhere to be found. You are right here with us. You are in our lives. You are active in everything we do. Help us to see that, to know you. In Jesus' name.
So normally, we just have a little background music going during communion. Today, we're going to play a song that we just haven't played in a long time. So if you all just want to remain seated and just continue to meditate and pray on what Brother David talked about in communion this morning, just use this time to talk to the Lord as we sing this song.
Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come. And in all my weaknesses, you are my confidence. Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come. And I will rise. Stand redeemed, heaven open.
That bridge, I could sing that bridge like 90 times and hit every worship leader cliche that there is about never stopping a song. So good. Anyways, if you guys want to stand, we're going to sing one last song today. This one should be one that most of y'all know. It's a common song. Thank you.
hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed.
And when I think that God, his Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my great.